Is your model training slower than you'd like? Perhaps your GPU isn't getting the kind of utilization you think it should? Then you've come to the right place, because we're going to level up your understanding of storage options for your machine learning and data science workloads. Welcome to AI Adventures, where we explore the art, science, and tools of machine learning. My name is Yufeng Guo, and on this episode, we're going to take a look at various storage options on Google Cloud. When thinking about running machine learning and data science workloads in the cloud, one factor that is often overlooked is storage. It's easy to take storage for granted. In our day-to-day, storage just happens on the hard drives of our phones and laptops, but in the cloud, things are a little bit different. Depending on your use case and your collaborators, your data storage requirements may have vast differences. So today we're going to look at some different types of storage options on Google Cloud and see what kind of trade-offs are being made so that you can pick the right tool for your task. Oftentimes, when we're doing tasks on Google Cloud, the default is to just stick files on Google Cloud Storage, which I'll refer to as GCS. You make a new bucket, stick some files in it, and you're done. Since GCS can be accessed over the network via REST API calls, often wrapped in a command line or SDK, it's become very convenient for a quick and easy storage solution when you need to drop a few files here and there to relay some bits around. The data gets replicated across multiple regions if you need to, you only pay for the exact size of the files you're storing, and sharing is relatively easy. This makes GCS especially useful for systems that operate in a serverless environment. But sometimes you need the performance of block storage. Enter the persistent disk. Yes, indeed, we're moving all the way down the stack to be closer to the compute resource and closer to the raw hardware. Okay, virtualized raw hardware. These disks offer high performance reads and writes, and your code sees it as a local file system, which can be very handy for migrating existing workflows into the cloud. Virtual machines in a Google data center are scattered across many physical machines, and they're all connected together via the fast local network. That applies not only to compute, but to storage as well. So what we see as a single persistent disk is actually many slices of different hard drives scattered all over the data center. This also means that you can easily connect multiple virtual machines to the same persistent disk, as well as connect multiple persistent disks to one virtual machine. All of these slices can read and write in parallel, which is why larger persistent disks will have faster I/O performance, up to a point. We can see that in this graph. Read speeds, they don't top out until after you have a 10 terabyte disk, while sustained throughput maxes out around 400 megabytes per second at the 4 terabyte disk size mark. Persistent disks have three tiers of choices: standard, SSD, and local SSD. Standard persistent disks are your good old spinning hard drive and are the backbone of most data storage systems out there. SSDs up the read and write performance, but it is still distributed across the data center in the same way as standard persistent disks. Now, local SSD is co-located with your compute resource, and it comes in exact increments of 375 gigabytes. So you should really only use it if you're sure that you're going to need that high performance read and write. Additionally, standard and SSD disks both offer zonal and regional options. With regional persistent disks, you can fail over to a second zone in the event that your primary zone has an outage, enabling you to have high availability services. In machine learning use cases, you can take advantage of the high I/O and throughput performance of persistent disks by loading large datasets onto a persistent disk and then attaching them in read-only mode to many, many instances. This will enable your team to work with very large datasets without duplicating the data, all while everyone gets to feel like the data is right there on their own VM instance. Note that for workloads that primarily involve small random reads, 4 kilobytes to 16 kilobytes, the limiting factor is random input-output operations per second, or IOPS. But for workloads that involve primarily sequential or large random reads, like 256 kilobytes up to 1 megabyte, the limiting factor is throughput. This means that you should set the block size of your disk to match the type of use case you anticipate. So which storage option will you choose? Well, that'll depend on your use case. From the scaling flexibility of GCS to the high performance of persistent disks, there's a storage option suitable for every type of machine learning workload. Thanks for watching this episode of Cloud AI Adventures. If you enjoyed it, click that like button and subscribe to get all the latest episodes right when they come out. I'm Yufeng Guo on Twitter at YufengG. And if you're looking for longer form machine learning and cloud content, be sure to check out the Adventures in the Cloud YouTube channel, which I've linked below. And for more on disk and performance, check out the resources in the description below. And I'll see you on the next episode of AI Adventures right here on the Google Cloud Platform YouTube channel.